seconds back to you, refer to the graphic. This is the area specifically. How's yeah. that in the
teeth? Okay, you go over there. On me for about 15 seconds, then the street scenes, and then up to the graphic. Then I'll mention the...
Make it yours.
Webster is next on BCTV.
Good morning. Three people have been injured by a random sniper apparently using a 22 caliber rifle in the west end of Vancouver. The affair began at about 5:45 this morning when a man walked into St. Paul's Hospital with a flesh wound in the arm. Police were instantly alerted. Shortly after, the police began to close in and sealed off most of the west end of Vancouver, from Nicola to Chilco and from Davie to the water. The action appeared to vary in the direction towards the Stanley Park English Bay Beach House, and police fanned out rapidly and formed two perimeter circles, one in inner and one outer, and all traffic was stopped in the area. The actual area affected is shown on the map right now. And at one stage, a suspect was arrested, but he is believed to be a B&E victim gathered up more or less by accident. Three people injured. More details on Webster after the break. Many residents of the west end of Vancouver were late for work this morning when they came down and found police blocking off the largest part of the west end of the city of Vancouver. Because sometime about 5:45 a.m., a man walked into the St. Paul's Hospital with a minor injury. The police tactical team was moved into the area, and when a second and third person, including Corporal Grant Driver of the Vancouver City Police Department, were injured, all minor injuries believed to be caused by a 22 rifle of some particular time, kind. The police also swept through the area of the English Bay Bathhouse, the beach, and those areas. So far, a suspect has not been called. Here is Corporal Grant Driver.
Corporal Driver, can you tell us what happened this morning?
Well, in the early hours of the morning, we received reports of shots being fired in the west end around the English Bay area. My units and myself attended and cordoned off the area. And as we were there at the scene, we heard 10 to 15 more shots ring out and had reports of windshields of cars and trucks being damaged. And finally, the person who was doing the shooting shot me in the arm.
Were you hit as you were getting out of your car?
No, I was already out of the car and I was maintaining observation, waiting for the earth containment crew.
Was this in the area of the beach house in English Bay?
Yes, it was.
Did you see the fellow who shot you at the time?
No, at no time could we ever see anybody at all.
Any idea from which direction the shots came?
Well, the direction was from a southeastern direction from my position. It was probably on top of the bathhouse itself.
What did you do the moment you were hit? What was your first reaction?
I hit the ground and pointed my service revolver at where I believe the shot came from. However, I couldn't see anybody.
Now, you're right-handed, so I guess you were using your wrong hand then as well.
Yes, I was.
Any idea what kind of gun it was?
Well, not for sure, no, but it's probably a small caliber.
22 rifle?
Yes, probably.
Did you hear the shot, the one that hit you?
Yes, I did. There were numerous shots all over the place, and I just heard the one that hit me just prior to it hitting me.
How are you feeling now?
A little nauseous, but very good. I'm fine.
Right forearm, is it? You got...
Yes, it is. Yes.
Have they told you when they're going to be operating on you?
Later on this afternoon, probably at 2 or 2:30.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
That interview was done by Webster reporter Steve Wyatt. In the West End, still keeping an eye on affairs for us, is Anton Koschany. Anton, where are you now?
Jack, I'm in front of the Sands Hotel, which is on the 1700 block Davie, just up from the corner of what they call Demon and Beach there, just up from the bathhouse.
Are the streets still blocked off in that area?
It's dead quiet in the West End right now. The police are, I just see some people leaving now. They let the people out, but they don't let them back in. So if people leave their homes, they're not allowed back into
the... And the advice is, are people standing at bus stops or not?
There were a few people. There's a bus in front of me, as a matter of fact, that hasn't moved for hours. But the people were here for a while, and they've now wandered on to try and find buses elsewhere.
Yes, and if you're in a car, of course, the police will let you through the West End, will they?
They will let you out. They will not let you into the area, out of the area that's sort of bounded by Stanley Park and Davie Street and then Nicola on the other end. They'll turn the cars away. They don't let you in.
Yeah, I had the report this morning that they were actually stopping and searching some cars in case the guy was off foot and in a car.
The plan was to search the cars as they were leaving, just inspect them to make sure that wasn't the person they're looking for.
The suspect's description I should give... white male, 6 feet tall, light-colored pants, perhaps white, dark top with maybe a brownish sweater, full-length dark hair.
Collar length, yeah.
Must be carrying. It sounds like, unlikely out of a .22 pistol, it must be a .22 rifle of some kind.
They're not certain. They know it's a small caliber, but they're not certain if it could be a handgun or a rifle.
Okay, Anton, thanks very much. You stay on the spot there. In fact, hold on, I'll talk to you during the break. Don't go away yet unless something big happens. Just back from the West End is Steve Wyatt. Fortunately, the officer, Grant Driver, does not appear to be really seriously injured at all.
No, he has a bullet lodged in his right forearm right now. He will be operated on later this afternoon.
What was that report about the man in the car? As I understand, how many were injured?
There are two for sure, and possibly three, but not seriously.
The man with the smashed windshield?
He was a driver in the area this morning. He is in a hospital now. His injuries aren't serious.
But was it the bullet that smashed the window of
his
car?
Yes.
What do you think down there? Was it just somebody wandering around at random?
It seems to be that way, Jack. It first started at 5:30 this morning. As you heard Corporal Driver say, that there were about 15 shots, so he was firing at random, it seems.
Very lucky nobody was seriously injured. Have we been able to pinpoint Driver was shot down at the English Bay bathhouse?
In that area, right.
Do we know where the others were injured?
The Corporal Driver was injured in the same area around the bathhouse. He was responding to a call there.
And the police had how many? I think they had a couple of perimeters.
They have six square blocks sealed off now, plus another area around the bathhouse and one further down on Davies.
So therefore they're concentrating the search, say, somewhere around the Chilco, Denman, and in that area.
That's right.
The beach and the bathhouse.
That's right.
There was a report that perhaps he was in the bush in the park. Nothing came of that you know of.
Well, last seen he was in the park across from the bathhouse where the gazebo is. That's where he was last seen. Then he was seen wandering around in an alley in the 1600 block Davie Street. They did arrest a suspect there, but now they're not sure that that is the one they're looking for.
They may find they have a B&E suspect or... whatever.
Yes, right.
But there's no question that these people were shot. One other person was shot, one perhaps in shock with minor injuries with his windshield smashed,
right.
Were random.
That's right.
Innocent victims.
That's right, Jack.
Of this man, whatever he is. And the West End, by and large, is still blocked off. Is that correct?
Entirely. Entirely. The traffic is a mess, to say the least.
Downtown?
Yes.
Stand by, Steve. We'll have more work for you later this morning. Back to normal business. We'll keep you informed with what's happening in the West End. Whatever happens, we'll let you know right away. We've got to do our normal business, and, well, it's not that normal this morning. Two of my, quote, little sneer favorite people, Harry Rankin, that contradiction in terms, part member of the establishment, leader of what I lightly call the civic Marxist group, and his lieutenant, Bruce Eriksen, the man who never smiles. We'll keep you up to date on this, and I'll be back with my political brouhaha to keep you interested after the break. There is no doubt that my guests are either liked or disliked in the field of civic politics. On my right is Harry Rankin. Harry Rankin is a veritable contradiction in terms. Harry Rankin is a member of the establishment. Harry Rankin is a former master treasurer of the Law Society of British Columbia, a man whose legal ethics shine and bristle like a knight in armor. Harry Rankin is a very left-wing civic politician at whom I am somewhat annoyed this year. I'd hate to see him, the mayor of Vancouver, but I feel he'd be a different mayor and he should have run. Don't say a word, Harry. Just sit there.
No, I'm just
smiling. I'm going to accuse you of chickening out. You're a Machiavellian man with a Machiavellian design. And he is the leader, the real leader. A man who's been in city council now for 14 years, sits there and snipes and snarls, and occasionally a touch of wit and humor, and often shows, I hate to admit it, good, sound, common sense between times. On the other side, I have a man who has done a lot of good in the East End of Vancouver, downtown East Side. And I don't get on very well with Bruce Eriksen. Similarly, I hate to admit that he has done a lot of good. He cleaned up the pubs when I was stuck down in Gastown. He was an abrasive, troublesome creature who shocked the liquor board into getting off their butts and taking some action. He helped a lot of people down in the downtown East Side. He's a man who drives me crazy. And the reason that Harry Rankin is not running for mayor is that he'll run next time once he's got his lieutenant securely on council as an alderman. Fair enough, Bruce. Fair enough, Harry. Any complaints about my introduction?
You're eminently fair, as usual. I mean, if I was to say anything else than that, you'd be offended. And you'd start to sulk and we could get on with this program.
Harry, I forgot to give you one plug.
Oh, sorry.
You are the committee of progressive electors who are desperately anxious to get the NDP candidate, Harcourt, elected, even though you are properly described, you're delicate about it, as a civic Marxist.
I'm not delicate about it and I'm not properly described as that.
Answer the question, witness.
That's Alderman Kennedy's version of civic politics.
Are you not a civic Marxist?
Well, I am whatever you want to describe me, but let me put this to you.
Chameleon.
There's a $190 million budget. $180 million of it is properly committed. We would be able to change maybe the direction of $10 million of that budget, probably for decent housing, some money for the Community Services Committee, and a few social things in the city. So to describe our group as anything other than civic reforms, civic democracy, not because I wouldn't like to go further, but the constraints of the position are that.
Your long-range political philosophy are not therefore connected with your short-range drive for efficiency, decency, and humanity at City Hall.
Look at the long range.
Am I right?
That's correct. But you see, the long-range things can't be done at the civic level. The long-range changing that is required in this country are federal, at least. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in civic government. I'm not like the others climbing my way up somewhere. But here's my job. Here's where I'm at. I'm 60 years old, and I'm content to do a good job there.
Harry, there's no way. We forgot to mention COPE. C-O-P-E. I meant that.
Committee of
Progressive Electors.
Right.
Now, you didn't respond to my barb that you are a living contradiction, a member of the establishment, but a political, what's the word? Not extremist. A radical, politically. That's a fair one. I'll come to you in a moment, Mr. Eriksen.
Well, what is the
hold your seat there, witness.
What is the contradiction? I was elected as master treasurer, which means at least a fair number of lawyers had confidence in me in that area. I was elected to city council for 14 years, which means that a fair number of the citizens of Vancouver have confidence
witness,
in me.
Witness, you are not
that
stupid, witness.
No, you bet
answer
I'm not.
Answer the question.
I'd say you bet I'm not.
We're having an intellectual discussion,
right,
witness.
Right.
And it is. The Law Society is the veritable pillar of conservative reaction.
Doesn't mean I support everything the Law Society does on either. I'll be appearing for a lady upcountry on the notaries thing next month.
Traitor.
You know. No. A lawyer.
Mr. Eriksen.
Yes.
We've snarled at each other many a time. So let me start snarling. How much in federal funds? Oh, it must be an awful lot. I mean, you're always moaning and groaning about no grants for this, no grants for that. But you and I know differently. You've done very well, and you spent the money well, out of federal funds. A million?
I haven't done very well. The downtown East Side residents.
How much money have you winkled?
$500,000. But we've put 150 people back into workforce who are now paying taxes, and they're an asset to the community, including one of your friends, as a matter of fact.
That's an unfair blow.
It's not an unfair blow. It's simply a matter.
You're going to make me
fact.
Admit that between us, we managed to get my nice little friend Nova back on the track of working from our dead ends.
That's right. I have people working in banks. I've got them working in stores.
But are you not a person who always overdoes it?
No. You know what? I'll bet you there's not one single person in this city, including the alderman up there or MLA or whatever, who can look at any issue we've ever dealt with, and that includes you, and say, listen, Mr. Eriksen, you were wrong about that. You know, when people say we're...
Some of your tactics have been reprehensible.
Well, the fact is, we go to the members of the council in a fair and honest, forthright manner. They ignore us, like the standards of maintenance bylaw. 8 years we've been trying to get it enforced. You are forced at last to take action that's going to get some notice. The fact is that all of the issues we dealt with have been fair. They haven't been left. They haven't been right. We've been saying to the members of council, look, you passed this law by a majority, enforce it. And that means liquor laws.
I remember you. And liquor laws, I'll give you full credit for. You went around and got thrown and beaten about on the beer pilots.
Give me one issue, even one, where we were wrong. You just don't like it that I keep bugging the hell out of you. That's what
I never did believe the business about 155,000 unenforced charges. What was that caper you had? You extrapolated
violations.
In the Balmoral? Well,
many violations.
We got the police report. It's all there in black and white.
I'm talking about the total number of violations you claimed.
In that police report, they're there. And as a matter of fact, in 23 hotels down there, picked at random, and we were helped by the city of Vancouver in getting the figures together.
Have they been cleaned up yet?
There were 10,000 violations. No. What they did was pass a new law and say, hey, look, we gave you a new law, but they never enforced the old one.
Have you not spoiled a lot of convenient accommodation for a lot of old boys by your insistence?
We have a 27% vacancy rate in the area. The fact is, if they moved the people out of the worst accommodation into the better accommodation, they would have full occupancy, right? And they could afford to repair some of their housing.
Hold your breath, Bruce Eriksen. He's been remarkably charming this morning, isn't he, Harry?
That's right.
Alderman Rankin.
But he's charming.
I'm always charming.
He gets things done.
We'll finish with the intellectual discussion here.
Right, let's get down to brass tacks.
You will concede. No, that's coming next. You will concede that you chickened out and that you should have run for mayor for the sake of your own pride and self-respect this year.
Listen, my pride and self-respect are intact. I will run for mayor when the Committee of Progressive Electors decide that's the right thing to do. And it will not be the right thing to do until we have some people on council. Now, the majority of the people that support me, not just the committee, the majority of people in Vancouver that support me understand that you don't get yourself elected mayor with a hostile council and lose, or not get elected and leave the place barren. There needs to be an opposition
at
City Hall.
The moment he gets in, you'll run for mayor.
The moment he gets in, we will then consider that at COPE and make the decision.
Issues next. I had my wrist slapped. Mind you, no, I won't make that. After the break. Let's look at the tactical situation. COPE. By the way, Harcourt doesn't really want your endorsation. Didn't you get the feeling the other day when Harcourt was on, you know, he didn't even know you had endorsed him? Is he trying to kind of disassociate himself from COPE?
I can't read the man's mind. All I know is that the Vancouver District Labor Council has endorsed both Harcourt and COPE, and COPE has also endorsed Mr. Harcourt. He's on the front page of our main leaflet. We're saying to people, vote for
Harcourt
and... Right.
Okay, next question. Where were you in the polls the last time? How many off a seat?
11.
How many was he off a seat? One?
One. He was number 11.
Number 11?
Yeah. Right.
So you're totally confident this time you'll make it?
Well, we have an extra 34,000. I'm probably going to be way up on top this time. Extra 34,000 voters.
Pride cometh all before tenants. A falleth.
All, it's nothing to do with pride.
Confidence is different than
confidence.
Pride.
All right, then what committee are you going to go for, and what committee will they put you on? Damn. Would you want to be put on?
Well, I think the Community Services Committee, which deals with neighborhood issues, is the one I'd like to be on.
You're a specialist on the downtown east side, and you'll continue, I presume, if elected, to concentrate on that.
Well, no, we don't concentrate simply on the east side. All of our issues, you know, the world doesn't end in the east side. We deal with transportation, we deal with housing. You know, a bylaw dealing with housing affects the whole city. So don't think that it's just the east side.
Well,
there's bad housing up
there. You're identified with the east side.
Well, of course, because I'm the president of the downtown east side residents.
Well, I forgot to ask you, are you a civic Marxist too?
Hey, listen, everybody is a civic Marxist to the social creditors on city council. The fact is
you're not calling Volrich and Puel and Bernice Girard, surely, supporters of right-wing philosophies.
Well, everything that's happening in this city is social credit initiatives, Expo 86, the whole damn works. But anyway, you know, Mr. Kennedy has the feeling that whenever anyone disagrees with him, that they're civic Marxists.
Fair enough.
Including Mr. Eckhart, who supported the ward system.
Eckhart.
He recommended a ward system for the city, and Kennedy says they're all civic Marxists.
Enough. Mr. Rankin.
Yes.
Give me some succinct opinions.
Yes.
Harcourt, your leader pro tem as mayor.
Yes, he's
wants to cancel Transpo 86. Where do you stand on this highly expensive, I presume?
Highly expensive.
Second class world exposition on transportation for 86.
It's a dead loss, and the people of Vancouver are going to know that. There's a $70 million people mover, 3 or 4 kilometers of line. You know what 3 or 4 kilometers is? About 2.5 miles.
You mean a moving sidewalk or
something?
Well,
sidewalks and this and that through department stores, hooking up the stadium with this group, with that group. You could walk it in about a half an hour.
The Transpo 86, would that be an integral part of Mr. Bennett's concrete monument, the avenue of the palace, his BC place?
I presume so. I presume it's tied in. You see, one of the problems in city council is, does anybody in Vancouver know what BC Place is, except there's a $1 billion price tag on it? I have no idea what it is. Nobody has told me. There is no information on it, except that it's going to be around $1 billion, and it's some kind of a pipe dream that's advanced to help the people of Vancouver and presumably the whole of British Columbia.
You don't even believe it, though, do you?
No, I do not. I tell you this, it is not in the interest of the people of Vancouver to get involved in that kind of a situation at this particular time in our history. There's a lot of other priorities, sensible priorities.
Is the stadium part of BC Place? No, that's a separate commitment,
stadium
isn't it?
Stadium is a separate commitment.
Are you gone for that?
I have gone for it in this sense. What I wanted and what I voted, I moved a motion that we have a study in the Lower Mainland as the best place to put the stadium. I still feel it would probably be somewhere, if the study was done logically, it would have been somewhere in Burnaby by their sports complex, where you could use all the roads and freeways.
But meanwhile, you're not
crowd.
Opposed to $100 million, providing the provincial government builds it.
Every last dime of it, and find some logical way to get the people in and out of there.
Volrich sat here and told me that PBC would not be a burden on the taxpayers of Vancouver. In your opinion, true or false?
False. Let me tell you what the start of it was. $25 million. $5 million capital costs from Vancouver, $10 million from the provincial government, and $10 million from the federal government.
Right.
It is now $56 million. We don't know what the end price is going to be. We are going to subsidize the deficits, and apparently there's only two stadiums in North America that ever made money, small amounts of money, and we are going to go without taxes forever on it. Now, if the people of Vancouver aren't going to subsidize that to the hilt on those terms, what do we have those kinds of obligations to meet? It's crazy. It's insanity.
I find a lack lusterness about this entire election. Do you?
Up to date, yes.
Why do you think that is, Bruce Eriksen?
Three lackluster morality candidates would be a starting point.
That's right. You don't have a real strong campaign on a mayoral level. I don't think that the community is
things are pretty good, in Vancouver at the moment. There's a tight squeeze on rental housing. But there's a very low level of unemployed at the moment, and actual jobless is about 4%.
Well, wait till the cost of all these here multi-million dollar projects start hitting the people's pocketbooks. Then you're going to see something. The fact is they're not thinking about where it's going to start hitting them in the pocketbook.
By the way, you said three lackluster candidates, including your own nominee.
Not my nominee, but we're going to support him. That's right. But they're not putting...
Cop supports lackluster... Hardcore.
Yeah, that we're not putting they're not putting forward the issues.
We're not running
in
their campaign
in sharp enough relief. In other words, you say things are pretty good. Things are pretty good for about two-thirds of the people. You know, 60% of the people. That's correct. Things are terrible for old age pensioners. Things are terrible for handicapped. Things are terrible for single parents on welfare. Things are terrible for tenants. Things are terrible for those people that are not in organized labor and are in, you know, in the lower echelons of things.
Harry, in the 30s, no matter what you say.
No. Look, I'm not saying that.
This is
and
the 80s.
I'm not. I lived through the 30s, and I'm 60 years old. And I'm not saying you don't duplicate things in that sense. But when you want to talk about things, you go and shop with some woman that's got $500 or $600 a month total income, or talk to people who are trying to find housing and have to pay $500 for a one-bedroom suite.
Now, you got to be a civil servant with two incomes.
That's right. Don't tell me that things aren't terrible for those people. And the fact of course, is, unfortunately, those people are the people who are silent, who do not have anybody to articulate for them.
Look.
Now, that's what I think the campaign is all about, doing something for all of us so that the city's a better place.
But there's a dichotomy, if you'll forgive the word.
I don't know what it means, but go ahead.
You and the others, and there is a parallel with you and Harcourt, in that you are committed to squeeze money from wherever to put the city into a fairly large-scale housing operation, using, I presume, CMHC, cooperative things, federal
grants. Is it a dichotomy? What do you mean? That there's a contradiction there?
No. Between you and Harcourt are together in that, and Voldrich and Zlotnick are not together in that.
Yes, that's right.
There's a basic kind of...
But let me put something else to you. When you clean up a slum area, when you give people good housing, when you do those things, don't think that it doesn't help the people that have got it. People who are housed well, fed well, looked after well, don't fill the jails and don't fill the insane asylums and don't cause the problems that cost us millions of dollars on the other
side of
the
ledger. How many housing units? We'll try this in Eriksen. No prompting from the audience.
Okay.
How many housing units would Cope and Harcourt, you know, could they in fact start to produce that's any different from what is being done now in a routine way in the next 2 years?
Well, let's put it this way. We're losing about 1,200 units every year through demolition. We should at least try to replace those units.
Any further detail you would add?
I would say that we could replace 1,000 to 1,200 units a year. We could place and stop some of the demolition so that some of those good units don't go off the market, so that we have to tear down schools, so people have to go to the suburbs and build schools. Stop the irrational use
of
public buildings that we are now presently facing.
Fair enough. I'm telling you what I'm going to do now. We'll keep you up to date on anything that happens in the West End. There's no 30 on the story yet. But I'm going to put up the phones and see if we can, if these two gentlemen, outspoken though they are, not particularly good looking, can attract any lucid telephone calls on the Vancouver Civic Election, which is happening on November the 15th.
Right.
It's a month early or something.
No, it's a couple of days early. It used to be a separate day for Vancouver. It's now Saturday, November the 15th.
Eriksen, Rankin, and my name is still Webster. After the break. I know what you do for a living, Bruce Eriksen, but I'm actually get paid for it, and who pays you? You run DERA.
$900 a month as a community organizer.
From?
From the Secretary of State. At least they appreciate the work I'm doing for this city.
Well, I have my own opinions, but $900, that's all you're getting to run the place.
That's
just
right.
The one salary.
That's right.
$900 a month.
Don't
one thing before I go to the phones.
There was 500 people that supported my job down there.
Before I go to the phones,
yes.
I made a fuss with Voldrich, and I'll check with you as to whether I'm ethically correct or not. I took offense to Voldrich and told him so when he admitted to me that no outside policeman need apply for the job of chief. No RCMP need apply. Handpicked successor. Only the one application. Not knocking Stuart.
No.
We will be the right man at the right time in the right place.
Yes.
But it sticks in my craw, Harry, that Vancouver gets a new police chief without open competition throughout the country. Now, are you with me or are you against me?
I'm with you. I think that any senior position should be open competition. It may at the end mean that you pick the most logical man, and my guess is with open competition, Stuart would have won. You know, that is my guess. But I think that to not have open competition smacks too much of the successor role, which becomes a very comfortable thing and has some inherent
dangers. It's not like an internal promotion in a city hall department where a guy goes through a question of routine and formalities. It's a question that every now and again you might need a fresh eye on team policing, for instance.
You might need a fresh eye anywhere when you're looking at the head man.
In the police force?
Anywhere else in City Hall,
on
too.
On City Council, too.
Any senior job, and on City Council, yes.
These are your friends who are phoning, by the way.
Are they? I'm
glad
to hear that.
The new firm of, not the new firm, Eriksen Rankin.
Mr. Webster, I'd like to direct this question directly to Mr. Eriksen. Now, these places that are being torn down and being rebuilt into apartments, what his renter structure will be in this particular situation? We're advancing to the age of senior citizens. Where and what can we expect?
Ah, you're looking for low-cost housing of some kind in the city of Vancouver. Is that right, ma'am?
Yes.
All right, the magicians will give you the answer, tell you how much rent you'll have to pay and when it'll be ready for you.
Yeah.
Well, the rent will be 25% of your income. That's what all of the senior citizens' housing is.
Who are you to state what my income will be?
Well, we don't state what your income be. Whatever your income is, all senior citizens' housing is 25% of your income.
Yes, but if there's no senior citizens available for her, a one-bedroom suite that is being built now will be $550 a month, regardless of what her income is.
You're telling me the formula for qualification
for
in these cost-shared housing is 25% of your total gross income.
That's right.
If you don't earn $550 a month, what happens?
Well, I'm saying if there was no senior citizens housing available for you, the going price today for any new unit, one-bedroom unit being built, is approximately $550. It's obvious that there's a shortage of senior citizens housing.
I wonder what the waiting list is.
And the
now.
Waiting list is a long one. In other words, if we built 2,000 units, they would be filled tomorrow.
You've got 1,200 people on your list?
Yes.
And you give that to the BC Housing Authority or what? Who handles these things?
We put their names into the BC Housing Authority. We're attempting through CMHC to buy up some buildings and build housing for seniors.
Plenty of old people get old and die before the housing units ever become available.
Best of luck, ma'am.
Hoping for.
Thanks, love. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Rankin.
Yes?
Mr. Rankin, if I'm not wrong, why isn't the common Joe who gets a vote, why isn't he allowed some input into these major problems like your
stadium?
The stadium and the foot of the Granville building and such things.
Well,
no, just a minute. Yeah. Now, light transit that we've been hearing about so long, and nothing ever happens. why aren't we allowed some input, say, by a simple plebiscite, so we can get something done instead of talking about this stuff for years and years and years until...
Good question.
All right. You can't rule by plebiscite.
Just a minute.
You can't have a plebiscite on every issue. You have to have a program that people run on and who are committed to doing those programs. Look, we had a referendum on the ward system. That didn't give you a ward system, although there was a majority. So why should you think that a referendum, which says that the majority of people want light rapid transit, will give us light rapid transit?
So you say that even although it's run by the Volriches et al. And the Zlotnicks or whatever, the fact remains that the city council must govern and should not necessarily govern ever by plebiscite?
Not necessarily, but there should be lots of opportunity for citizens' input. That's another question. There should obviously be meetings, and when you get the consensus of people by meetings that they want... Look, today people want a light rapid transit system. They want it now, and they want some politicians that'll get busy and build it.
I don't believe it'll ever happen.
Well, no, I'm beginning to think the same thing, at least in my lifetime, and I'm planning on living at least as long as you. But forgetting that, What you need to do then is start to build. You can't have consensuses and discussions forever. We've got bales of documents.
Enough. Hey? Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Webster, I'd like to talk about what you're saying about things are going so well and in the city. And you look at the train of things that have happened from the summer, the riots that are going on in the summer. Some guy shoots up four people in one of the downtown hotels. There's a sniper out on the streets. And you're saying things are going really well.
Well, first of all, I wasn't around for the Sea Festival riots, which seemed to me to be extraordinarily poorly handled by the organizers and also by the police, to an extent.
If we connect this and you look at John Turvey's article on the headline of the Sun.
Listen, I've read John Turvey's article. I'll take that with a large pinch of salt.
I used to know
the street scene, and I think I still do, but Mr. Rankin, he's complaining about me saying things are generally good.
Well, I think we're talking about two different things. This gentleman is talking about something that I think is correct. Things are materially good for a big section of the people here, materially, but not socially good. You understand what I mean by that? You can have people living in a fine house, alcoholism.
Oh, Harry, don't tell me you're going to move social workers into every house in Shaughnessy.
I am not talking about social workers. We have ample social workers. We have ample talk. I am talking about an environment in total, in which people can live without the massive stresses and strains. Look, let me just give you an
example. You sounded like a social worker.
Look, let me just give you an example. It doesn't matter what I sound like. I'm going to talk to this gentleman that's
okay,
on the air.
Okay, talk to him.
You know, when you start to say, well, we're going to put another 150-foot height on a building, only one building, to make another rat trap down there, to make the West End have another 10 or 15,000 people in it. You just put that many animals together and they all of a sudden turn to cannibalism. We have to create environments in which people can live with some dignity. And part of that means not just the physical buildings, but the total environment. And I think that's what this gentleman's talking about. And if you analyze that question of the scene in any North American city, things are not getting better. Now, I'm not saying Vancouver's the worst of them.
No way.
But our job is to make sure that Vancouver never gets into the situation of the New Yorks and the Chicagos and the Los Angeles, etc.
And you were talking about this 150 extra height for the marathon building behind PBC at the waterfront.
Yeah, that's right.
Special concession.
That's right. And that's one of the things that destroys our environment.
I'll agree with that.
The two buildings on the waterfront that makes a
I'll agree with that. But
the city violates its zoning bylaw, and Marathon comes in and says, well, you did it, why can't we?
See, I think this gentleman is talking about something that's happening, a phenomenon that's happening in large cities.
You want to go back to the old country or go to Europe today, and you'll find that Vancouver's as clean as a whistle in many ways.
Vancouver's a great city. The province is a great province. But it's our job to see that it doesn't deteriorate and that we do the things to keep that from happening without patting ourselves on the back endlessly.
Give the gentleman a last nag. Have your nag at me, sir.
Yes, I'm just going to say that it's a matter of looking at it in a preventative way. You say, like, you hear all the beefing and the complaining about social workers. Well, I've seen a lot of good social workers have the same kind of thing happen to John Turvey, and people who really damn well do give a care.
That's right.
Thank you,
and
sir.
They get band-aids to do a major job.
I remember well the Vancouver Resource Board, and I wasn't sorry to see it go. You were.
I was, and I think it did a good job, and I think there's a lot of people will support that proposition that it did a good job. And you tell me, you know, without making sort of general statements, you tell me what was wrong with the things that we did in the Vancouver Resource Board.
I haven't got time.
You haven't got the information.
I will take a phone call. Nothing else I want to nag you about, I don't think.
Why not? Just go 52, ahead.
52, lost a lot of weight.
Yes, no, he was always lean.
I worked very hard.
He was not. I remember when he was quite fat.
No, he never was. I was.
Yes, you were. You still jogging every day?
Not every day, but about 3-4 times a week.
Didn't you have physical trouble after all your jogging?
A hell of a lot less physical trouble than you seem to have. In other words, I'm about 25 pounds lighter than you.
I've got more hair, though.
And probably will live a lot longer than you with your coffee and your cigarettes.
We have a bet, you know, don't
what?
We?
Who's to die first, you mean?
No.
Oh.
Who's going to pay?
What's the bet?
I better not say on there.
I'll give you a $50 bet that you die first.
No, I won't accept that. That's a gullish, tasteless,
horrible remark, only worthy of origin from a former master treasurer and civic Marxist.
But it's worth, you know, it's worth fighting for.
Are you trying to make me jog?
Sure.
My knee bones would collapse.
I know, but you should reduce first, and then you can jog.
They don't recognize him then.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, Harry was talking about the environment. I think everybody in the council and that is getting things wrong. We have one of the worst sewerage systems. The whole Gulf of Georgia is pretty near a cesspool now.
Yes.
And for $20 or $30 million at Iona or Anasis, or they could upgrade the sewerage system. Forget about these big sports complexes and trade buildings and that. Let's start basic and get the thing straight.
I thought we had a good sewage system.
No, we don't. We have a treatment that is simply a matter of chemically treating the sewage and dumping it out. It's raw sewage.
Oh, no, come on. It's we've raw got a plant sewage. Iona. We've got huge tunnels.
No, we've got treatment stirrers out there. Forget it. That's a myth. The gentleman's correct.
We need
a tertiary treatment plant where the chemical...
We don't have a tertiary plant.
No. No.
Secondary.
We have primary. Not secondary. We have primary treatment, which is simply next to nothing.
Yeah, that's right.
That's right. No, I agree with you, sir. There's no argument.
Somebody was suggesting that Button's Bog should be used for the land.
That's right. But you, look.
Land disposal of sewage.
Yeah. No, not. Well, that's garbage.
Oh.
See, and that's another thing, the second thing, garbage. The only way you can deal with garbage right now cheaply is dump it in the ground and put earth over it, which means you're losing massive amounts of materials, paper, tin, glass, etc. Secondly, that you're just, you know, it's just the wrong way to treat garbage.
Is this part of your program or just dreams?
Well, that's the regional district, and it could only be done by the 17 municipalities. Those are two things that ought to be done immediately.
Thank you. You're an honest man, Mr. Rankin, by and large, within my definition of the terms, even though you are a politician. Can you tell me, if you believe, that the regional districts, the regional parks boards, the city councils, and all the rest of them are efficient organizations, or, as I suspect from ignorance, feather-bedded organizations?
Well, let me put it to you this way, that the regional district and the city councils are probably about 50 times as competent to run their funds as the provincial government, and about 1,000 times as competent to run their funds as the federal government, which still makes them somewhat the kind of place that you described. In other words, there could be a lot more efficiencies, but by and large, municipal councils have small budgets and are relatively efficient. The real question isn't efficiency alone, it's priorities of efficiency.
Okay.
Priorities.
That was just something crossed my mind the other day. We have a chief constable retires, he's obviously got a handsome pension, he's only 50, he picks up a big job with some outside organization.
Racetrack.
We certainly treat them well, don't we?
Yes, we do.
Too well, perhaps.
Or they can run for council.
Frankly.
Who's running for council?
Well, we've had quite a few of them.
Oh, Doug Little, ex-city clerk. Good, crisp man, modern liberal views.
Ex-fire chief.
We've got Armin Koenig. Well, we always elect ex-fire chief. Yeah. Shuey Bird was on
he
there
He lives
for
in
years.
West Vancouver, so he should be a good ward alderman.
It's a supplement to your pension. I mean...
You're sounding like me, Eriksen.
No, but you asked a serious question.
Yeah, I did.
Are they overpaid and overpaid?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so. I don't believe that, and I have always taken that position. But I think that we could get a lot more efficiency out of some of our services.
Okay. Only time to do a quick survey, very briefly, about Rankin and Eriksen. Go ahead, please. Oh, I took the wrong one. Hold on, please. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, Mr. Webster.
Yes, sir.
I object to you, gentleman is Marxist. Point one, because when you make that intimation, that to a lot of people it sounds like they're communists or what have you. And I've known Harry Rankin quite a bit. He doesn't know who I am right now. But anyway, what I would like to do is this. With Mr. Rankin and, Eriksen in this case. Bruce Eriksen, I mean.
Don't make up your mind.
In regard to the Minister of Consumer Affairs who you had on the other day, and that... And being that Bruce Eriksen had so much to do with all the liquor business, this sort of thing...
Ask a question, for goodness sake.
The question is this. When the Minister of Consumer Affairs was on, he was going on about the shelf price of liquor. I wonder if you're aware that there are 1,000 cases of booze that the consumer pays for at the new price which the liquor board... at the old...
Don, do you get the question?
Okay, the other question is, I would like to return to Vancouver, but I can't because of the high rental cost.
I can understand you, sir, and I haven't time to go into it now. I didn't get his first question, did you?
I think what he was saying is that what happens is that the price of liquor goes up. The liquor that's in the store at the old price is sold at the new price.
Well, you know,
I'm not really concerned about that too
Meals?
Much.
No, you don't drink anyway.
No, not only that, I don't. It's not a question of just not drinking. Other people can drink. I think if you looked at liquor prices, they haven't gone up any more than less than food prices.
Quite seriously, though, there's a guy who objects to me in my semi-tongue-in-cheek calling a civic Marxist.
Yeah.
Do you want to make a statement of policy and principle?
Well, look, you're a fink, but everybody should know that by now. What I'm really saying is simply that, you know, in the city council, you are a reform group. There's no way you can establish socialism, communism, Marxism at the city council level. Everybody with an ounce of brains knows that.
Nor fascism,
that's correct, and I've never called anybody a fascist.
No, you haven't, only through
N. You know, the fact of the matter is, we have a program. We've tried to elucidate that program today, and when a guy throws that word in, you know, he shows his ignorance. You know what you should do with ignorant people? Not give them any coverage.
Ignore
and
then
people it was me that called you. It was Kennedy that called you, and I picked
that's
up a
right.
civic Marxist.
That's right.
It's a good way to jab you, because
you are such a
politician nowadays, it's difficult to deflate you. You're such a member of the establishment.
I'm not deflatable easily, but I think I have a common sense program that people can support. COPE has a common sense program that people can support, and I think we should fight it on issues. Sure, you should have a little pizzazz in terms of putting those issues forward.
That's right.
But you ought to have
civic reform.
But you ought to have the issues.
We used to have a great organization called TEAM, didn't we? And were not Volrich, Zlotnik, and Harcourt all members of TEAM at one time?
Yes.
Whatever became of it?
Well, they had their official merger with the NPA the other night. I noticed a hell of a lot of TEAM members up there.
And you were there, all agal in the world.
Oh, I went up there to
see what was happening.
To cover it. I'm a
reporter. For your paper?
Certainly.
You just go there to annoy them.
Well, I suppose it annoys them, too. Good for them.
Enough. My thanks to Bruce Eriksen, thanks, and to Harry Rankin, the standard bearers, for COPE.
For the city of Vancouver.
For COPE. I'm going to have a word with a couple of women from the Consumers Association of Canada. Ruth Lotzkar, a partner. I will bring you up to date with the West End Sniper after the break. Steve and Anton and Webster will be back near the end of the program with the updating on the sniper in the West End, where, in case you missed it this morning, two people were injured for sure. One person may just be suffering from shock. One windshield smashed. The West End sealed off. And Corporal Grant Driver has perhaps a 22 bullet in his right arm and is not seriously injured. Glad to tell you that, because the police were out in force and apparently acted with great promptitude this morning. Now, the other day I delivered myself of one of my own personal experiences. Scanners. And I just don't like scanners. Maybe I'm getting a little slow. You know, going to the store in West Vancouver and wham, wham, ping, 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 ping. And she's doing this over here and I'm saying, why is she pinging it four times? And the readout is coming up here and it says tea, coffee, milk, whatever, whatever, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I can't identify.
Yeah.
If I go home, I can apparently match them in that particular store. Consumers Association of Canada, represented here today by Ruth Lotzkar, mm-hmm. past national president, and Betty Therriault. Mm-hmm. What is your attitude to scanners? What is the score, the position, and what's happening?
Okay. We're not.
Am I right or wrong? My own personal experience.
We think you're right, right on. And I enjoyed your program on this last week with the minister, Mr. Nielsen.
Didn't get very far with him, did I?
No. Because he's not a consumer minister.
He never
in
goes
our
shopping,
estimation.
Obviously.
No, it was apparent to us he didn't go shop. He doesn't shop. Mm. Doesn't understand the consumer viewpoint at all. Now, I want to just say right off the top, we're not opposed to the computerized systems per se or the scanner. What we're opposed to is the fact that they're keeping the prices off. They're taking all the prices off the canned goods, the boxes. That we for years and years and years enjoyed having so that we could comparison shop and make wise purchases if we so wish.
You mean are all the big stores doing this?
in BC, it's the only province in Canada where when the scanning systems came in just a few years ago, about 3-4 years ago, they immediately removed the prices. We're the only province that they dared to do that.
Why would we be the only province where
because
they dared to do that?
They feel they had done some testing out here of consumers, and they feel consumers in BC are more adaptable to change.
No,
than
is there
in
not
the
a
is
there not a, is there not a more abrasive answer? Is it or is it not a fact, Ruth, baby, that some provinces, oh, forgive me, yeah. Mrs. Lotzkar.
No, you can call me Ruth.
You can call you Ruth.
That's right.
Ruth Baby is a sexist remark. Let me not say that again. Is it not a fact that some provinces have in some way restricted the use of the pricing with scanners?
That's right.
Where?
In Ontario right now, the Minister of Consumer and Commercial Relations has actually told the supermarkets that they should maintain the prices. And just to go back, in Ontario, they came in with scanners at the same time they did here. The first one was in Dorval, Quebec. And then they came out with some here, but they got a they brought a few in Ontario, but they were afraid to remove the prices because people are more conservative there.
More competition.
Yes, and also the big factor, there's far less concentration of supermarkets in Ontario.
What have we got? We've got Super Value, Safeway, Woodward's.
And Woodward's, and those are the big three, and Safeway's the price leader. They're sort of the leader here. And as you know, they're very, very shrewd about the way they concentrate.
Now, not all stores in BC, though, have these scanners. I go to Super Value
no,
in Park Royal,
no.
which I happen to know and which
That's
I occasionally
right.
shop in.
Mm-hmm.
And if I were quick enough, I could cope. Or if the scanner and the thing was at the same site, I might be able to see.
But you really can't cope because they have removed the prices in Park Royal at Super Value.
I've got to put on my glasses.
And
to
you
see
cannot
anything.
See the shelf prices adequately. Seniors with glass, eyeglass problems, hard of seeing, handicapped people just have told us by in the droves
but
that they
surely
can't
if
see
I
them.
Were of an official of one of these supermarkets, Betty Therriault, I would say, because of our computerization, because of our increased efficiency, because of the fact that the shelf price is on the shelf, I am able to give you a better deal in your groceries. Is that not my logical and perhaps proper answer?
Well, maybe they could give you a better deal, but I think the fact they're removing prices takes away the price consciousness.
Is it, when you say the kind of Campbell's tomato soup or something, is that now off the end?
Yes, there's
yes.
no mark on individual item pricing.
And do the cans too have scanner things on them?
Yeah. Well, they all have the UPC. You know what that looks like, that little postage stamp broad lines, which is a universal
oh, yeah.
product code. And that's where it goes into the scanner. And immediately it crosses the scanner, the price is in the computer.
Why do they sometimes put it over four times, or twice, or whatnot?
Well, loose packaging, maybe the frost on ice cream hides it from the scanner. There's various things that the scanner doesn't work on.
But
they
I've got to trust
problems.
The girl to make sure to only register the once.
You've got to
correct?
Listen for that beep, because if they've got music going and people talking, it's very difficult.
If
to
I've got
beep.
Six cans of Heinz tomato soup this time, and does she put it over six times?
She can either put over one tin six times and quickly throw the others in the bag, or else she'll do each individual one. She has a choice on
what
that.
Progress have you made in attempting to get the government to attempt? What do you want is the best thing?
We want the minister to meet with the chain heads, Safeway, Woodward's, and Super Value. Those mm-hmm. are the ones that we're concerned about in BC. And we want him to do the same as the minister did in Ontario. Say, look, put those prices back. It's what consumers want. The Ontario government took a survey, and 90% of consumers in Ontario want prices on.
You want the man to keep going around with the G-rubber stamp and everything,
right.
doing this and that yeah. and the
you
next
You know
thing.
Why? Because you can't compare prices this way. You walk, and there's a new trend in stores to dividing products. Like, the soups aren't all together. They're starting to put some brands down at the ends and so on. And you just can't remember because you don't have the price on the
you
product.
You mean Campbell and Heinz aren't together?
Not
they are in a lot of stores
yeah.
Still. But
then
the
I can look at the price of Campbell's and the price of Heinz.
Yeah, but you see,
if it's not on the item, you can't do it.
But it's on the shelf.
Yes, but if they're not close together. The other thing is, if you buy a can of peas and frozen peas and fresh peas, they aren't together. You can't
That's
compare
right.
which is the best buy that way.
And you've had no luck at all with the. What's his name?
We
Nelson.
Have met, no.
I had no luck with him either
no,
the other day.
No.
I gave up on
no.
the
and, you know,
exercise.
He is not pro-consumer. He's really a corporate minister.
He talks status quo, but we already have the prices. That's what status quo is. We're having the prices removed.
Not in all of the big stores?
I'll tell you what. Woodward's has only got one scanner so far. Safeway has, I believe it's four scanning stores out of, you know, a large number of stores, over 20. But they're now, as you know, through an article in the paper that you mentioned last week, going to remove prices at the, I guess, the bequest of their Oakland office. You heard about the memo
that they got.
That's right. And they have another system, not just scanners. There's another system called data terminal systems, DTS. And the Oakland memo said remove prices off those. And they are computerized checkouts, but they don't have the little window that scans. Mm. That's the thing that differentiates the different types of computerized
systems. If I've got a price, maybe you can't answer this question, maybe I should get it from one of the stores, but if I've got a data ticket, or a UPC, or whatever you call it there, and the price on the shelf at the moment is 98 cents, and I want to reprice my stock, I can reprice it on the computer.
That's right.
Instantly.
Instantly.
You just plug it into the computer. You just punch it in.
So that means all old stock at previous prices would be automatically repriced at the new price.
That's right. You get no savings.
Quiet, please. Calls on the scanner to these two, can't say ladies anymore, these two Carsons, Ruth Lotzkar and Betty Therriault, CAC. Big stores must have been very persuasive to the government. If they're not, if the government is not prepared to listen to you, they just don't listen to you.
I don't understand why not, but what
it's such a popular issue, unless I'm wrong, of course.
No, it is a popular issue.
I mean, the women sit down and say, oh, so-and-so scanners, do they? Does it annoy, or are people, by and large...
Do you think 900 letters to a minister on a certain... issue isn't important to him? He
not
says
enough.
That's it's not enough.
No, he need 9,000.
Letters, though. These are letters.
Well, like Pennywise and a famous campaign on colored margarine, coloring margarine.
Well, we had 6,000 petitions and surveys.
We had
900 letters.
Okay, LD2 from Quesnel. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I've done a number of consumer reports for CBC over the years. And in BC, we have the most. Some of the most progressive legislation, consumer legislation, and your conversation with Mr. Nielsen last week, it seemed like he just completely ignored it and tossed everything out the window with one fell swoop. He said he hadn't, as I recall, he said he hadn't had that many complaints except from organized.
That's correct.
Consumer groups.
Said a couple of complaints or something.
Yeah, so he completely disregarded.
He couldn't have cared less.
He completely disregarded what the CAC's been doing for the last 10 years.
I want to respond to that. We don't think he's telling the truth in this. We really don't. So now we're telling people, don't write to Jim Nielsen. Write to your MLAs, the premier. And what we've done is we have just last week asked for a committee of cabinet meeting in Victoria, and we're going to go even if we don't get them. To meet with us. If they don't, we're going to go with our signs and things to the steps of the legislature, and we're going to meet with the opposition because they do support us in this.
Well, the people out of power always support you.
I think that's correct. And also, Jack, you mentioned you sometimes an item has to be rubbed across the scanner four or five times. Mm-hmm. That's happened to me when I was living in Vancouver at the Kingsgate Mall. You stand in line forever waiting for the thing to register. And it seems to slow down the works rather than speed it up.
Oh, for the good old days, McGill used to say tea. $2.10. $2.10. Yeah. Put it over.
That's a key point because they don't call the prices anymore because they're not on the containers now. They can't call them.
They don't even know them, I don't suppose.
That's right.
Thank you so much, obliged. Go ahead, please.
Hi. We've just had a new Safeway store open in North Delta, and they've gone on to the scanner program. And I've been shopping up in Safeways now for 4 years, and I'm not going to go back again because of this scanner.
How old are you? You sound in your early 30s.
Yes, I am. I work full-time, but I have always been a good comparison shopper.
Married and two children.
Yeah, yeah.
And ESP's working today. My ESP's working today. And you're like me. That it just puts you off, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. And I also did nursing training in Glasgow, by the way, Jack. So...
Well, to me, a good something or other.
Yeah.
But anyway, you just say you don't like it, it's too fast for you.
I don't have the time to comparison shop the way
That's
I
right.
used to.
Mm.
I can't go around looking from shelf to shelf at these product.
Good. Good point. Keep the heat. Thanks for calling. Go ahead, please. Hello. Nobody there. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, Jack, I agree with you about the scanners in the food stores, but I think one thing that maybe the ladies would like to comment upon, if you want to get a real eye-opener, go into the Sears store in North Vancouver, check out the scanner system they've got there. Like, the song and dance we were given was that it was supposed to be so fast. The one that they've got working in there is just unbelievable. I can hardly wait for Christmas to roll around. Not only do they... Not only do they punch up the little numbers that are on the tag itself,
yeah.
then they have to take their scanner pen and run the darn thing over about
that's
half a dozen times before it registers.
Mm-hmm. Well, tell me, you're not talking about groceries.
No, that's a good point. It won't stop at groceries. We will be having it.
But if I'm buying an item at $14.95, I know that before I put it through the scanner.
Yeah, okay, but you see, we're not only talking about the food pricing. Yeah. Now they're getting into general merchandise.
Correct. It's going to be everywhere. This whole thing is just the beginning. Food is the area they chose to introduce it to because it's the one where you shop the most. So it's leading into computerized checkout systems throughout the whole merchandising field in the big chains.
You check out that one at the Sears store.
Mind you, the point, that's a good one. The point is that you just can't. It's like VDTs and newspapers. It's like ENG
yes,
cameras on
right.
television.
Yeah. Yeah.
We can't turn back the clock against computerized progress. And are you people prepared if the big stores come back and say, sure, pass along, we'll put the price on, and they'll put up the average price of a grocery basket by 65 cents? Are you prepared to pay for that?
I think we are.
There are. Yeah,
I'm
we
sure
consumers
are.
Half a cent an item at one time.
You're prepared to pay for that?
That's right.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have to because all the tests that they've done in the States, and they've done a lot on this, have shown that consumers overspend. Like, they spend remarkably more each week if there's no prices on products.
Personal question. Are your eyes purple or your glasses purple?
They're kind of blue, I think.
No, but these are purple glasses.
Yes, I guess so. Kind of bluey purple.
And they make your eyes look purple.
Do they?
Yeah.
Mm.
Lady with the purple eyes. A purple people
eater. No, they've just got, I think, a little darkening in the top half to prevent glare from getting to my eyes.
Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
Jack, I think Safeway there has...
Men calling. Yes, yes,
yes,
good.
They are interested.
Same idea concerning consumers as they do about food, but I think the key word is processing. There's very little regard these days for people's economic... you know, to some people, a dollar here, a dollar there means something.
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
Other people, I don't think Safeway's taking that into consideration at all.
And there are other people, you know, the two-income families and no kids are so affluent they couldn't care less.
That's right. They
one social worker, one teacher at Webster to get in the needle, or two civil servants, you know.
They can ask for a raise and compensate any
They
cost
get the raise automatically,
sure.
and
That's
they've
right.
got index pensions down
right.
the road.
But the majority of our letters were from old-age pensioners and people on a limited income.
That's probably your strongest point, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't really complain about a cent here or there, but I like to know what I'm buying.
No, but we feel it's a lot deeper than that. It's just taking away our right to hold in the information we need to make a wise choice. It's a deep thing.
It's going to happen. You're going to have to make a bargain somewhere along the road. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, hi. I work for one of the stores, and I've been in one of the scanner stores. I got confused, and I think the best method right now is the DTS method.
What's a DTS?
That's data terminal systems.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right now, like about half the store, all the hardware goods, everything is still priced.
Mm-hmm.
The bulk items, like say, like your orange juice and your ice cream and that, where the checkers all know it and they just
code.
That's right.
When the price goes up, the code is still the same.
Who puts the price up on the code? Is that done on a computer somewhere?
Yeah, that's in the office.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If I buy a spatula at the hardware section, it's still got the ticket on it.
It's still got the sticker
on
it.
The sticker on it.
That's right. But don't be confused. You're still going to lose your prices on each individual item on the data terminal system.
They're everything.
Yes.
It's coming.
It's much slower than
Does it make life easier for you as a store employee? Does it make the operation to ask a fair question more efficient?
I tell you, if we'd all get that Well, I don't know if they cut the staff down, but I tell you, our night crews would be happy. All they have to do is cut a carton up and throw it on the shelf.
You mean they don't have to stamp it?
Yeah.
Don't have to take it out?
They would also cut back on their night crew, surely, if they don't have that work to do.
Yeah, because one person could do the work
eventually
too, just
it'll
about.
Lead to unemployment.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, what offends me most is that as a consumer, I lose my cost consciousness over time.
That's right.
It's easy with items like milk or bread, which you buy daily, and you can remember the price of to compare between stores. But over time, items like staples, baking goods, things that you only buy every few months, when you go to replace them, the price has gone up so much, and I can look at my old jar of vanilla, which I've had for 6 months, and suddenly see my, gosh, it's leaped up 50 cents.
Well, now, but you still shop in a scanner store, don't you?
No, I don't right now. First of all, because it's not convenient, and they offend me because I'm nearsighted and I have an awful time reading the labels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like me.
You see?
Yeah.
And she sounds
And
young.
I always my glasses in my car instead of in my pocket.
That's right.
And then I'm doing this business.
Mm-hmm. Wear my glasses. I'm not as vain as you, but I still have
It works too, you know. You know, you haven't got your glasses with you.
Just take them.
You just make a little tube with your fist and you can read it, but it certainly holds up the line in the queue.
That's right.
The ones that bleep up, you know, and they print out for all the world to see what you've just purchased.
But some come up, I mean, in the Super Value where I go to occasionally, it comes up that's written out.
It is, in great big letters. Now, if you're purchasing personal health items or something, that can be embarrassing for people. But what bothers me most is that this insidious price creeping up all the time and you don't notice.
But aren't there other places where they just punch up a code?
Yes.
I haven't seen that. Well, you get when you've got your groceries, what do you get?
It says right out. It'll say the brand name and the size and everything.
Not always, though.
Wasn't somebody telling me something about some places where you get a code and you've got to have the
interpretation
of the code?
I can find it. I'll get it.
And it's done by a code number. That's DTS, and that will be
real garbly thing. That's the data terminal system.
Well, in other words, here we are.
Right
45 PL, 70 cents PR.
And it uses red and blue hieroglyphics.
799 GR. Mm-hmm. What is that? How can I check
You can't.
How can I check my groceries when I get home?
Could I point out that a lot of people are under a misconception about the newer, improved tapes? They don't tell you the brands and sizes. They do tell you oranges so much, grapefruit so much, Parmesan cheese, but they don't give you the brands and sizes. So if you keep these, which Safeway and Woodward says you should, and Super Value, they don't give you anything to check back on 2 months from now because they'll have four.
Well, in other words, you can't compare your prices.
They do not give brands and they
Fair
don't
enough,
give
girls.
Sizes.
Fair enough, girls. Very quickly, are you for or against scanners? Are you for or against scanners?
No.
Oh, good, confused. I think I'll finish it there. I've got to do my wrap up in the West End. My thanks to Betty Therriault of the Consumers Association of Canada, as the English used to say, and to Ruth Lotzkar, the lady with the purple eyes, past national president of the CAC. I'll be back with an update in the West End Sniper. Steve, where are you? Anton, are you on the phone? After the break. Steve, has anybody been arrested yet in the West End snipings?
Not the person they suspect. One person was suspected or arrested this morning, but he's not the person they want.
How many injured now?
Three.
Three injured. No, none seriously injured at all?
None seriously, no, Jack.
Take it away.
It started at 5:30 this morning, Jack. This is the scene on Davie Street about 6:30 this morning. The street was literally deserted except for a lot of police, and traffic was beginning to be diverted around the area. A total of six square blocks adjacent to English Bay have been shut down. You can see the street there is just deserted.
Wonder how many people were late for work this morning? Quite a lot,
Several. The traffic was a nightmare around the area. This is Corporal Driver who was shot in the forearm.
As we were there at the scene, we heard 10 to 15 more shots ring out and had reports of windshields of cars and trucks being damaged. And finally, the person who was doing the shooting shot me in the arm.
In the meantime, police were sealing off Denman Street and the whole area around English Bay Beach.
Okay, we can't let you go any further. Okay? So if you back up and turn around, go the other way, okay?
That continued all morning, and now 5 hours later, and here's a tactical squad arriving on the scene. They're still combing the area, Jack.
They believed it was a 22 caliber
They suspect that's what it is, Jack, because the bullets are small. total of about 15 shots fired.
You have a suspect in custody now. Are you sure this is the one you're looking for? There seems to be some confusion.
I don't have knowledge that he's the sniper.
Can you tell me the sequence of events leading up to this particular arrest, though?
At approximately 5:30 this morning, there were reports of three shots being fired in the 1600 block beach, and the police responded. One of the police members who did respond, Corporal Grant Driver, was approaching the beach area, and he was shot in the right forearm. I understand another civilian person was shot through the window and apparently wasn't injured too seriously. There was a report of a third person being shot, but I can't confirm that.
Can you determine how many shots were fired?
Apparently there were several fired. I don't know how many for sure.
You're still continuing your search at this point, though, are you?
Yes, the tactical squad is on the scene. They have been sweeping the beach area, and then they'll move on to the next area from there.
Great, thank you.
Here's the tactical squad down near English Bay Beach, and now police confirmed that three people were indeed injured. One, a Mr. Fred Simpson, who is 38. He was sitting on the seawall when he was shot. He's not seriously injured, and he has since been released. And someone else was grazed while
One word from Anton. Anton, is it all quiet in the West End now, or are the streets still blocked off?
Streets are blocked off. It's quiet. Chief Bob Stewart just drove by the section here where some of the press are gathered, and he said that it's like looking for a needle in a haystack. The guy could have gone into his apartment and couldn't...
Hold on, Anton. I've got to take my break. I'll be back with Anton, Steve, and Gladys after the break. Anton, what else can you tell me as you come up to the end of the program on the sniper incident in the West End?
Jack, the police teams, they've organized a series of teams, and they're sweeping very slowly, very meticulously through the lanes and down into the underground parking areas and in through the various areas, trying to see if they can find anyone. But the odds are, as Chief Bob Stewart said a few minutes ago, that if the guy lives around here, he's gone back to his apartment. I'm guessing there must be at least 50, 60 apartment buildings in the immediate area that's cordoned off.
Many policemen around? 100?
Oh, it's hard to tell. There's almost one at every corner or a couple at every corner, and they're watching cars coming and going. They won't let you in, of course. They're watching the cars coming out to make sure the suspect doesn't leave.
So a lot of people who normally would be out shopping and wandering around are staying home this morning.
It's very quiet.
To be on the safe side. Well, just let me recap. Grant Driver, corporal, not seriously injured. Fred Simpson sitting on the seawall, not seriously injured. Windshield of another man's car smashed with apparently a 22 caliber bullet. The man not believed to be injured. Is that right?
That's right, and many hours of searching still before the police are sure that the area is cordoned off.
We only got 10 seconds to go. Tomorrow morning, Gladys.
David Halliwell, for sure.
My thanks, Anton Koschany and Steve Wyatt and the camp film crews. Back tomorrow morning, 9 a.m.